We shall commence this module by discussing about international trade. International trade today, more than ever before, is the driving force of economic activities. It is not an end in itself, but a source to a greater end, that is, economic growth with development. The principal objective of trade is not merely to earn foreign exchange, but also to boost economic activity. India's trade regime has experienced significant changes since independence. With the liberalization since 1991 in particular, the significance of international trade in India's economy has grown noticeably. As a result, the ratio of international trade to GDP rose from 14% in 1980 to nearly 20% in 1990s. Further, it increased from 29% in 2004-05 to 41.8% in 2013-14. Given the trends of globalization and liberalization, the openness of Indian economy is predictable to grow further. Changes in India's trade regime over the period of time have been examined in two broad phases, the pre-reforms era and the post-reforms era. After starting this module, you shall be able to know about the evolution of India's trade policy since independence, know about the present scenario of India's foreign trade. Let us discuss about pre-reforms era first. Since the commencement of planned development in 1951, India followed strong inward-oriented policies. Starting with severe import restrictions in 1951, there was a gradual shift towards import substitution. The objective was to save the scarce foreign exchange for the import of more important goods and achieve self-reliance in the production of as many goods as possible. No doubt that this policy changed the structure of imports and contributed to some extent to the process of economic growth, but at the same time, the country followed a passive export policy, which resulted in export pessimism. During the late 70s, there was a shift from import substitution to import liberalization, but this also contributed little to the export promotion. The period of 1980s saw a more positive approach towards export promotion strategy. The incentives for export production were enhanced and export promotion became an integral part of industrial and economic development. Export policy in this period emphasized on technological upgradation, increase in the size of plants, freer exports, and domestic and international competition for the entire industrial sector as being essential for export promotion. The trade regime in India since independence has passed through three distinct phases. The first phase, which covered the period 1951 to 76, pursued the plan objectives under a physical control regime. The four major physical control instruments, industrial licensing, foreign exchange regulations, control and regulation of monopoly and restrictive trade practices and import controls, were evolved to direct private investment in conformity with planned objectives and targets. Operating in a protective shelter, the industries faced very little competition either internally or externally. In the second phase, that is from 1977 to 84, the policymakers recommended liberalization in industrial licensing and moving away from aggressive inward orientation towards export orientation. A greater role for the private sector was suggested by limiting the role of public sector. It was also emphasized that the performance of the public sector should be improved through higher productivity and better management. They also recommended a shift from physical controls to fiscal controls. The third phase, from 1985 to 91, made some major departures from the earlier regimes, such as removal and relaxation of physical controls, restoration of competition, reorientation of fiscal policy, modernization of industries with high-tech bias, and a bigger role for the private sector. The liberalization process resulting from the introduction of the new economic policy yielded several positive results, like 5% plus growth and a fairly high rate of growth in the manufacturing sector, but at the same time worsened the macroeconomic balances, eventually leading to a crisis situation in 1991. India restored to stabilization and structural adjustments loans from the IMF, initiated economic reforms in July 1991, and the package comprised fiscal deficit reduction, tax reforms, industrial and trade reforms, and financial sector reforms, etc. The objective was to restore the macroeconomic balances in the short run and to move to a higher trajectory of growth in the medium and the long run. These goals were sought to be achieved by creating market-friendly environment for enhancing the competitive strength and integrating the Indian economy in the global system. Moving on to discuss about post-reforms era. The trade policy reforms initiated in 1991 have immensely changed the foreign trade scenario and have resulted in the shift from inward-oriented to an outward-oriented policy. The period after 1991 has been marked by a substantial liberalization of the trade policy. While some liberalization measures were necessary to make exports competitive in the international market, some were undertaken under the pressure of the international agencies as a part of the stabilization and structural adjustment program. Moreover, with India joining the WTO in 1995 as a founder member, it was under an obligation to strike down all quantitative restrictions on imports and reduce import tariff so as to open up the economy to the world trade and the forces of globalization. The trade policy as it evolved over the years since 1991 focused on freer exports and imports, liberal exchange rate management, rationalization of tariff structures, and many changes in the system of export incentives. It is framed around the twin objectives: A. To double the percentage share in world merchandise trade in the next 5 years. B. To act as an effective instrument for growth of an economy by giving a thrust to employment generation. The goals are proposed to be attained by implementing the following strategies. First, removing controls and creating an atmosphere of trust and transparency to encourage entrepreneurship. Second, simplifying procedures and bringing down the transaction cost. Third, facilitating development of India as a global hub for manufacturing, trading and services. Fourth, identifying and nurturing the special focus areas which would generate additional employment opportunities. Fifth, bringing about technological transformation and infrastructure development of all sectors of the economy through import of capital goods and equipments, thereby increasing the value addition and productivity while achieving internationally accepted standards of quality. Sixth, revitalizing the Board of Trade by redefining its role, giving it due recognition and inducting experts on trade policy. Seventh, activating the embassies as key players in export strategy and linking our commercial wings abroad through an electronic platform for real-time trade intelligence and inquiry dissemination. Let us now discuss the foreign trade policy of 2009 and 14. Objectives. The short-term objectives of the trade policy are as follows. A. To control the declining trend of exports and put them on growth path. B. To achieve an annual export growth of 15% with an annual export target of $200 billion by March 2011. C. By 2014, a high export growth path of around 25% per annum to be targeted. And D. To double India's exports of goods and services by 2014. The long-term policy objective is to double India's share in global trade by 2020. To meet these objectives, the policy measures to be adopted by the government include: A. Improvement in export-related infrastructure, reduction in transaction cost, and providing full refund of all indirect taxes and levies. B. Fiscal incentives, institutional changes, procedural rationalization, enhanced market access across the world, and diversification of export markets. Features. First, increased support for market and product diversification. Elaboration of incentive schemes with addition of new product and markets. 16 new markets in Latin America and 10 in Asia, Oceania have been included under focus market schemes. Increment of incentives from 2.5% to 3% under FMS. Increment of incentives from 1.25% to 2% under FPS. addition of more products from different sectors for benefits under FPS. Inclusion of products classified under as many as 153 ITC HS codes at 4-digit level under Market Linked Focus Product Scheme known as MLFPS. A simple uniform application format to claim benefits under FPS, FMS, MLFPS and VKGUY. More allocation towards schemes such as Market Development Assistance, that is MDA, and Market Access Initiatives, that is MAI. Technological upgradations. Boost to technological upgradations by introducing EPCG scheme at zero duty for selected products. New towns recognized as towns of export excellence. Status holder. To strengthen exports and promote technological upgradation, status holder shall be given additional duty credits. Scripts at 1% of the FOB value of past exports, which can be used for procurement of capital goods with actual user condition. Transferability of duty credit scripts allowed under condition. Export promotion capital goods, that is EPCG scheme. To enhance the lifespan of working plant and machinery, export obligations on import of spares, molds, etc. under EPCG scheme reduced to 50% of the normal. Extension of FPS benefits for exports of green products and for certain exports originating from Northeast. Marine sector. Fisheries sectors relieved from maintenance of average export obligation under EPCG scheme, given that fishing trawlers and similar items shall not be permitted to be imported under this provision. Marine sector along with gems and jewellery sector given more flexibility under Target Plus scheme or Duty Free Certificate of Entitlement scheme. Agriculture sector. A single window system to facilitate export of perishable agricultural produce has been introduced to reduce transactions and handling cost. Pharmaceutical sector. Export obligations period for advanced authorization has been raised from 6 months to 3 years as is available for other products. This sector has been elaborately covered under MLFPS. Handloom sector. To simplify the claims under FPS, requirement of handloom mark for availing benefits has been done away with. Export oriented units, that is EOUs. EOUs have been allowed to sell products manufactured by them up to a limit of 90% instead of existing 75%. They will now be permitted to purchase finished goods for consolidation along with their manufactured subject to certain safeguards. Promotion of value added manufacturing. A minimum of 15% value addition on imported inputs under advanced authorization scheme has now been prescribed to promote value added manufactured export. Duty Entitlement Passbook, DEPB rate shall also include factoring of customs duty component on fuel where fuel is being allowed as a consumable in standard input output norms. Directorate of Trade Remedy Measures. A Directorate of Trade Remedy Measures shall be set up to enable support to Indian industry and exporters, especially the MSMEs, in availing their rights through trade remedy instruments. Now, we will discuss the foreign trade policy of 2015-20. The new 5-year foreign trade policy from 2015 to 2020, announced in April 2015, provides a framework for increasing exports of goods and services as well as the generation of employment and rising addition to the value in the countries in keeping with the vision of Make in India. The government focus is to upkeep both the manufacturing and the services with a superior emphasis on improving the ease of doing business. Features. Merchandise exports from India scheme, MEIS. This scheme has been introduced by merging 5 different schemes which existed in the earlier trade policy. These included FPS, MLFPS, FMS, AIIIS and VKGUY. There would be no condition attached to the scripts under the scheme. Next, Services Export from India Scheme, that is SEIS. This scheme replaces the Served from India Scheme, that is SFIS, and shall apply to service providers located in India instead of Indian service providers. Next, all scripts issued under MEIS and SEIS and the goods imported under these scripts would be fully transferable and usable for payments of custom duty, excise duty and service tax. Next, manufacturers who are also status holders will be allowed to self-certify their manufactured goods as originating from India with a view to qualify for preferential treatment under different PTAs, FTAs, CECAs and CEPAs. Next, boost to make in India. It is proposed to give higher levels of rewards to products with higher domestic content and value addition as compared to the products with high import content and with less value addition. Next, trade facilitation and ease of doing business. The DGFT already provides facility of online filing of documents or applications and paperless trade in 24/7 environment. Next, new initiatives for EOUs, EHTPs and STPs. These have been allowed to share infrastructural facilities among themselves. This will enable the units to utilize their infrastructural facilities in an optimum way and avoid duplication of efforts and cost. Moving on to understand the structure of India's foreign trade. Growth in volume of India's foreign trade. With the introduction of trade policy reforms and economy opening itself to the world economy, the volume of India's trade has increased many fold with imports growing faster than exports. The value of exports increased from $9.9 billion in 1984-85 to $314.4 billion in 2013-14, whereas the value of imports increased from $14.4 billion in 1984-85 to $450.2 billion during the same period. The rapid growth of imports as compared to exports resulted in mounting trade deficits, which increased from $4.5 million in 1984-85 to as high as $190.3 billion in 2012-13, which declined to $135.8 billion in 2013-14. However, the percentage change increase in exports and imports have fluctuated over the period. Post-2000, the rate of growth of exports has been more than 20% except during 2012-13 when it registered a negative growth and subsequently recovered to 4.7% in 2013-14. In case of imports, the rate of growth has fluctuated during the past 2.5 decades. Composition of India's foreign trade. An examination of the composition of the foreign trade enables us to analyze the progress of the country and the occurrence of the structural changes. The commodity composition of India's trade has undergone many changes since liberalization and has been driven by trade policy, movement in international prices, and the changing form of national demand. At present, manufactured goods constitute more than 63% of exports, followed by crude and petroleum products with a share of 20% and agriculture and allied products with a share of 13.7%. However, the share of manufacturing products has declined, whereas the share of petroleum products has increased considerably over the period 2001 to 2014, the share of agriculture and allied products remaining almost constant. The top 7 products, which accounted for 80.9% of India's total exports in 2014-15, include petroleum products 19.4%, gems and jewellery 13%, agriculture and allied products 12%, textile and allied products 11.6%, chemicals and related products 10.1%, transport equipment 8.5%, machinery 6.3%. Amongst these, petroleum, agriculture and allied products, gems and jewellery and electronic goods have recorded a declining trend in share in the past 3 years. In contrast, some sectors like transport equipment, machinery, chemicals and related products, textiles and allied products and base metals registered a positive growth. The main items of imports in India include food and allied products, fuel, fertilizers, paperboard, manufacturers and newsprint, capital goods, chemicals, pearls and precious stones, iron and steel, non-ferrous metals, gold and silver, electronic goods, etc. Over the period 2001 to 2014, the share of fuels has increased from 33% to 40% and that of gold and silver has decreased from 11% to 7%. The share of remaining goods remaining more or less constant. Let us now discuss the direction of India's foreign trade. There has been a significant diversification in India's trade in recent years. Analyzing it region-wise, graph reveals that India's export shares to Europe and America have declined over the years, whereas shares of India's export to Asia and Africa have increased. India's export share to Europe and America declined from 23.6% and 20.1% in 2004-05 to 18.6% and 17.2% respectively in 2013-14. Conversely, the shares of India's export to Asia and Africa have increased from 47.9% and 6.7% respectively in 2004-05 to 49.4% and 9.9% respectively in 2013-14. The share of Europe in India's import also declined from 23% in 2004-05 to 15.8% in 2013-14, while the shares of Asia and Africa increased substantially from 35.6% and 3.6% in 2004-05 to 60.7% and 8.1% respectively in 2013-14. The share of America in India's import has increased from 8.8% to 12.8% during the same period. Let us now recapitulate what we have learned from this module. The trade policy reforms initiated in 1991 have drastically changed the foreign trade scenario and have resulted in the shift from inward-oriented to an outward-oriented policy. The period after 1991 has been marked by a substantial liberalization of the trade policy. The foreign trade policies announced by the government from time to time provide a framework for increasing export of goods and services, as well as generation of employment and increasing value addition in the country, in keeping with the vision of Make in India. The focus of the government is to support both the manufacturing and the services, with a special emphasis on improving the ease of doing business. The volume of India's trade has increased manifold, with imports growing faster than exports. Despite the declining share, manufacturing products still constitute more than 50% of exports. Also, there has been a significant diversification in India's trade in the recent years.